Good afternoon. How's everybody tonight? Hope you're doing well. Thank you all for coming to see our very own Dr. Matthew Pettway speak on his insights and research into Afro-Latin American literature and culture. Today's talk is entitled, The Ghost of Slavery in Black Colonial Cuba. Dr. Pettway hails from Detroit, Michigan, where he grew up and later received his doctorate in Hispanic Cultural Studies at the Michigan State University. In 2013, he was awarded the Langston Hughes Visiting Professorship at the University of Kansas, where he taught on gender and race in post-Soviet Cuba, as well as Cuban literature at both the graduate and undergraduate levels. His family roots run as deep as South Carolina, where his grandmother was born just south of Charleston and Beaufort. As many of you know, Dr. Pettway is a postdoctoral fellow at the School of Languages, Culture, and World Affairs here at the college. He teaches classes in Spanish and Latin American and Caribbean studies. In fact, that's where I first met Dr. Pettway. In my introduction to Latin American and Caribbean studies course, I encountered his passion for uncovering the mysteries within the Latin American and Caribbean region's history and culture. Additionally, I saw his keen eye for detecting nuance in issues of complexity. Dr. Pettway led the class in a way that embraced complexity and explored the idea of mixed identity and the phenomenon of chosen heritage in previously colonial lands. As a woman of Caribbean descent, I thoroughly enjoyed a learning environment that explored these topics without Eurocentric judgment, all the while pursuing a deeper understanding of the region and its sociocultural diversity. I fell further in love with the histories of people of varying hues and heritage, rising above political oppression, securing la libertad in both heart and the public sphere, and defining what it means to be American, Haitian, West Indian, or Mayan. Today, Dr. Pettway will take us on a similar exploration as he investigates how Black Cubans writing under political duress and censorship found innovative ways to portray their African-inspired spiritual identity. He will draw from his doctoral research, which focused on the role of Black writers in Cuba, as well as from his published articles, such as Manzano en el Monte, Recuperando el Sujeto Perdido en Un Sueño a mi Segundo Hermano, and Ritual and Reason, Negotiating Freedom in the Literature, Juan Francisco Manzano. Additionally, this talk serves as like an accompaniment to his book manuscript, currently under review and entitled Black Cuban Literature in the Age of Conspiracy. Today's lecture furthers a conversation begun in these works and invites you all to join in the discussion. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Pettway.
Good evening, and thank you so much for joining me tonight here at the College of Charleston. Though I am originally from Detroit, Michigan, it is for me somehow very important, if not powerful, that I find myself here tonight, being that South Carolina is where my grandmother was born. She didn't speak too often about South Carolina. She didn't provide us with an opportunity to think through the complexities of the region. But I'm finding that my research does, and I'm finding that being here provides me with an opportunity to do that. I want to begin tonight by thanking Professor Lola Colomina Garrigos, the Chair of Latin American and Caribbean Studies. The Latin American and Caribbean Studies program has been very embracing and very warm. And though he couldn't make it tonight, Professor Mark Del Mastro, Chair of Hispanic Studies. I've been enjoying my time here as a postdoc at the College of Charleston. But with regard to my talk tonight, my lecture, In Search of My Brother, The Ghost of Slavery in Black Colonial Cuba, I want to dedicate my lecture to the Charleston Nine. I want to dedicate my talk tonight to those African Americans that lost their lives in a racially motivated terrorist attack. To Reverend Clementa Pinckney, Cynthia Hurd, Reverend Sharonda Coleman Singleton, Tawanza Sanders, Ethel Lance, Susan Jackson, DePayne Middleton Doctor, Reverend Daniel Simmons, and Myra Thompson. May they rest in peace. What do we choose to remember when we recount the story of a slave society? This is a curious question to pose in the heart of the old Confederacy and the first state that seceded from the Union to defend the right to enslave. Rice was to Charleston what sugar was to Havana, a labor-intensive cash crop where black labor made white wealth possible. The Lowcountry is in debt to Africa. Africans from Sierra Leone introduced a system of rice cultivation into South Carolina, and black rice, Judith Carney, demonstrates that planters in South Carolina, quote, adopted African expertise in rice farming to develop plantations based on the crop, end quote. Slavery is either remembered romantically as a peculiar institution, quote unquote, of Southern gentility, or as a dysfunctional family of sorts, where everyone knew his or her place. In some cases, slavery is remembered as a shameful and unmentionable era, better left unspoken in polite company. Throughout the Southern United States, the material splendor of the plantation obfuscates the physical horrors and psychological violence of the slave labor camp. And I'll be using the term plantation and slave labor camp interchangeably because I want us to think about the plantation both as locus horrendus, as a horrible place, but also as a sacred space where the bones of the formerly enslaved have been buried. What do I want you to remember from my lecture tonight? I want you to know that if we are to create democratic praxis in a former slave society, that the only way we can achieve this is to look to the institution of slavery itself. For in the institution of racial slavery, we find the antithesis of democracy. We locate a not too distant memory of a white supremacist ethic of domination, based entirely on arbitrary categories designed to extract labor for maximum profit and to deny a people their humanity in perpetuity. I want you to know that slavery will never go away until we atone for it. I invite you to ponder what it would mean to live in a society where we remembered slaves rather than their earthly masters. What are the cultural politics of remembering slavery? What do we gain from the proper use of history instead of its rampant and deliberate misuse? And I want to refer very briefly to a top government official who recently compared enslaved Africans to immigrants. Said they were pretty much the same. And it's painful because he's from my hometown. I will not mention his name tonight. Let us partake in an intellectual feast, a feast of thinking and feeling, a banquet of ideas designed to satisfy our psychic cravings, to fill our epistemological voids, and ultimately transform our structure of feeling. But I'm interested in approaching this question by looking at Havana rather than Charleston. And I ponder what we might learn about the descendants of enslaved Africans if we consider their religious practices as an imperative for cultural survival, their religious practices as a must for cultural survival. When is survival radical? And what did black radical love look like in Cuba in 1838? My talk today will be about a poet by the name of Juan Francisco Manzano. I'm going to use a pointer here. These representations, this is a mural from an old Havana. And this particular representation of Juan Francisco Manzano is not portraiture because there's never been any portrait taken of him or painted of him. He is standing next to the other poet that my book is about, Gabriel de la Concepción Valdez, otherwise known as Plácido. And you'll notice that the artist has distanced them from the larger literary community that they were very much in communication with. It's a beautiful mural. I hope that it will be the cover for my book, Knocking on Wood. But I want to talk briefly about Juan Francisco Manzano, and I want to encourage you to think about him. Try to imagine that you knew him. Try to think about Juan Francisco Manzano as you would Frederick Douglass, as a Cuban Frederick Douglass. So like Frederick Douglass, he's an enslaved person that's later freed or manumitted. Like Frederick Douglass, he produces a narrative about his life, a slave narrative, that was called often the autobiography. And the memory of that narrative was kept alive by a small group of white reformists who were very concerned with preserving his legacy. for their own reasons, but they were very concerned with preserving his legacy. And to their credit, we have his slave narrative in its original form. But there's a couple of differences we should think about. One, that Manzano didn't live as long as Frederick Douglass. He didn't become a representative of his government. His life ended rather early, after about 50 years. And unlike Douglass, there's far more of an emphasis on African spirituality in his work. So those are some of the differences I want us to think about. Let us begin briefly with this map of Cuba. Miami and Havana are only 90 miles apart. That's where Juan Francisco Manzano was born in 1797. There's been some debate about the year of his birth, but most scholars agree that was the year. And Matanzas, where he was raised on the sugar plantation, is not too far away. So when we think about Juan Francisco Manzano, I want you to know that his mother was María del Rosario and that his father was Toribio de Castro. Manzano had three younger brothers, Florencio and Fernando, and another whose name remains anonymous. His sister actually was a free woman called María del Rosario. She was granted freedom and she received some former schooling. Like most people in colonial Cuba, Manzano was required to have a Catholic religious baptism, but he was also someone who was socialized into African religious culture. In 1821, he published his first book of verse called Poesias Líricas, or Lyrical Poetry, and he published another book in 1830. What's significant about that is that it's the first book of poetry published in Cuba by anyone black or white that we know of. Another difference between Juan Francisco Manzano and Frederick Douglass would be that 5 years before Mr. Douglass published his first autobiography, Manzano published his only autobiography, but in English in London in 1840. Manzano became free through a process we'll just call a quid pro quo. Essentially, his literary patron, who was concerned with suppressing the slave trade, concerned with the demographics changes on the island, called for Juan Francisco Manzano to write a narrative of his life and said, if you write the narrative of your life, we will purchase your freedom. We will purchase your freedom. So this is the quid pro quo. And here are some of the important dates I want us to keep in mind about Juan Francisco Manzano. Before Manzano's mother passes away, she charged Manzano to take care of his siblings. And after his mother dies, we don't know the exact date of his mother's death, Manzano escapes the sugar labor camp. We believe it's around 1817, sometime around 1817. Once he arrives in Havana, he is not instantly freed, but he teaches himself to read and write, another thing he has in common with Mr. Douglass. And from Havana, once he's launched his literary career, the proposition is made that if he will write his slave narrative, he will be freed. He wrote his autobiography, but what I find interesting, and this is the moment we'll be talking about today, is that while Juan Francisco Manzano is producing that autobiography, he also begins to negotiate his brother's freedom, his younger brother's freedom, Florencio. Manzano begins to negotiate that freedom with a postscript. I want to say that again, with a postscript. So if you've ever written a letter and anyone's written PS, that's a little message at the end where they just want to throw something else at you. They might say, I love you. Why haven't you been around or whatever? Well, Manzano was, in his last letter to Domingo del Monte, his literary patron, wrote one of those, one of the PS, essentially. And what he does is he uses that, he turns that almost into a second letter. And in that second letter of sorts, he begins to negotiate his brother's freedom. So we're interested in that text today, that postscript, which reads like a letter of its own. And we're also interested in a poem called A Dream to My Second Brother. A Dream to My Second Brother. There's a couple of concepts I want to briefly introduce today. One of those is cosmology. Cosmology is one of the concepts I want to introduce. Wyatt McGaffey has defined cosmology essentially as a concept of the universe and the place of humankind within it. He says man, but I'll say humankind, right? The place of humankind within it. Cosmology is somewhat similar to grammar. It's a concept of the universe, but it's not the sort of thing that you're taught in a doctrinal way. It is rather the sort of thing that you're socialized into. So when I teach Spanish, I don't expect my students to explain to me why the preterite is the way it is in English, though English is the native language of most of my students. Because it's the sort of thing that they know, that they presuppose. There's that sense of it feels right to me, it sounds right. And I want us to think about cosmology in that way. So even though Juan Francisco Manzano was baptized in the Catholic Church, he writes about this in his slave narrative. His father actually plays the harp at the event, and his mistress is overjoyed because they are domestic slaves, essentially. And so they're important to her family. But even though that's the case, there's that other process of socialization at place. There are the proverbs that he hears. There are the rituals that he may have seen. And I want us to think about that. And this is the way in which cosmology is passed on. It's being told to do something, even if you're not provided an explanation for doing it. So when we talk about cosmology, cosmos from the Greek meaning the universe, and logos meaning reason, the controlling principle in the universe. We're going to talk a little bit about that today. The other concept that's important for us is radical love. Radical love. And I want to define radical love by speaking about the work of Joy Kennedy and Thomas Grinder. They rely on Black feminists and biblical paradigms to articulate their definition of radical love. And I'm going to read very quickly their definition. We define the term radical love as the empathetic, active, and passionate impulse to transform social relationships in ways that seek justice and freedom, end quote. Quote, a radical kind of love seeks the liberation and well-being of others, end quote. I want us to think about this in relationship to Manzano. I want us to ask ourselves what we can learn about freedom if we look at the enslaved, not only as victims, but as persons, as thinking persons, as persons capable of providing philosophical work. Black feminist Bell Hooks says, quote, I share the belief and the conviction that it is in choosing love and beginning with love as the ethical foundation of politics that we have best positioned, that we are best positioned to transform society in ways that enhance the collective good, end quote. So I want us to think about radical love as having an empathetic and a salvific element to it, but to understand that it necessarily leads towards liberation. Juan Francisco Manzano's mother, María del Pilar, was in failing health. María del Pilar had already lost her husband, Toribio de Castro, a domestic manservant and a harpist, and the family's fortunes had changed for the worse after his death. The modicum of protection that Toribio was able to guarantee his family, and his son, Juan Francisco in particular, had all but vanished. María del Pilar watched in horror as her son was beaten, publicly disgraced and pilloried, locked in a coal cellar, or placed in an old slave infirmary for the slightest of youthful blunders. So I'm going to show you an image here to portray what it means to be pilloried, essentially. On the, I think it's your left, but my right, you can see the example of someone being placed in the stocks. And this other image here, which is actually not produced to talk about Latin America, but I want to use it in that regard, demonstrates a mother's child being separated from her. And so one of the conditions of Juan Francisco Manzano's socialization is that being a favored son of sorts, this is not a quote, but a favored son of sorts, he was in a position where he was being taken to French operas, taken to church, learning catechism, but he was also being taken away from his family. And he would be taken away from his family sometimes for 5 years at a time. Now that's the sort of thing today we would call kidnapping. And I want you to think about it and to try to think about it from Juan Francisco Manzano's perspective. As a child, he doesn't understand what's going on. As he gets older, he begins to understand. The slave narrative represents that understanding. And understand the importance of kinship, or the negation of kinship in slave regimes, I'm going to read briefly something from Hortense Spillers, a very important African-American cultural theorist. Quote, certainly if kinship were possible, the property relations would be undermined, since the offspring would then belong to a mother and father. In the system that Frederick Douglass articulates, genetic reproduction becomes then not an elaboration of the life principle and its cultural overlap, but an extension of the boundaries of proliferating properties, end quote. The extension of the boundaries of proliferating properties. In other words, the relationship between mother and child, whether that's a daughter or a son, changes from one of the daughter belonging to her mother, and it changes into a situation where the woman is producing in a way that increases the bounty or the wealth of the slave owner. And so this is the relationship that Manzano has to deal with as a young man. We need to understand that in order to be able to understand what love looked like for him. And I want to propose that one of the biggest components of it, beyond empathy, was the ability to tie the family system back together. The first of our passages or quotes from tonight is actually in reference to Juan Francisco Manzano speaking to Del Monte on behalf of his brother. So you may have a paper in your hand. I don't know if we have any more. But that sheet, we're going to use that sheet just in a second when we begin to talk about Manzano's negotiations. I want to show you the text as much as I possibly can and do a close reading, albeit quickly, of the text. But before we can understand what Manzano was trying to rebuild, I want us to think a little bit more about what Manzano lost. And I'm going to read briefly a passage here that juxtaposes the violence he was subjected to with the love that his family practiced. Quote, Manzano discusses an incident from the slave narrative where his mistress accused him of something rather mundane, stealing a coin, and she punished him severely for it. Quote, they carried me to my dungeon 4 days and nights. I was there without the end of my arrest in sight. Finally, at the end of the fifth day at 6 a.m, they opened the door. All this time, I did not have anything to eat except what my brother and another person gave me, sliding the food under the door. From the foot of the stairs, my brother watched me with teary and swollen eyes, holding my old cloak and his little straw hat under his arm. He had not stopped crying since he had learned of my fate. We loved each other so dearly that whenever he ate a half orange, I would take the other half and the other way around. We ate, played, ran every errand, and slept together. And so this union, tied by the indissoluble bonds of brotherly love, had been broken, end quote. So I want us to think particularly here about the love between the two brothers. You have his brother essentially waiting at the foot of the stairs to see what's going to happen to his older brother, Juan Francisco. You have Florencio, presumably, waiting at the foot of the stairs to see what's going to happen. And though he's looking, he's observing, his observation is not surveillance. Manzano's not being surveilled by his brother, excuse me. And I want us to think about that, the difference of the gaze, the way his brother looks at him, the union called indissoluble, something that could not be dissolved, was now being torn apart. The marchioness of Prado Ameno, who was Manzano's owner, condemned him to what he poignantly described as a dungeon, his dungeon, which was probably the coal cellar. So he was in utter darkness. He was deprived of daylight. He had nothing to eat. Any food that he receives is slipped under the door. So it would be something like solitary confinement today, to give you an idea. What we also want to understand, even though kinship was legally was being denied persons of African descent, that there were a series of strategies that were adopted in order to establish brotherly ties. So María de Carmen Barcia explains that familial relationships meant much more than, quote, a temporary or provisional refuge, end quote. They entailed lifelong brotherly ties and serious ethical commitments. That language of refuge is going to be important when we come back to Manzano's poem. More than any other set of circumstances, the death of Manzano's mother, circa 1860, marks his transition from adolescence to adulthood. Juan Francisco became responsible for settling her earthly affairs and procuring his own manumission from slavery. Before Manzano's mother died, she explained the situation with perspicacity. Quote, Juan, here I carry the money for your liberty. You see, your father has already died, and you'll be a father to your siblings. They will not chastise you again, end quote. This is the pivotal moment in the text because his mother seems to have an idea that her transition is coming. And as a result, she passes on to him the small inheritance that he has. It's presumably small, but it's large enough for him to purchase his freedom. So it would have been a significant sum. This is her plan, essentially, to liberate her son so that he can then take care of his other brothers and sisters. The plan was thwarted because Manzano's mistress essentially took possession of the money and informed him that he had no right over that money or a right over anything else because he was her slave. At that point, Manzano escapes from Matanzas to Havana, circa 1817. And it's after that escape that he begins this process of trying to put the family system back together. And I want to pick the story up there with four major sections of analysis. The first one is called Appealing to Earthly Powers. The second one is Dreaming of Freedom. The third is El Monte, African Tabernacle. And the last one is Falling Like Icarus from the Sky. Now you'll be able to make good use of those handouts. So let me actually show you the passage. This is Manzano's final letter to Domingo del Monte. Remember, he's been in Havana now for several years. He's already begun to publish. He's published what is the first book of poetry, as far as we know, by anyone black or white in Cuba. But he's not free. He's not free. And so now he's concerned with securing his own freedom. Let's read the postscript together. I've highlighted certain parts of the text that I'll speak about briefly. Quote, Mr. Don Domingo, relying on the goodness that your grace has bestowed on me, I beg of you that you send the letter tomorrow in order that I might make the most of Monday to send it Monday by whatever means available to me, because every day that passes, my brother's fate becomes more dire. If your grace, if my brother's disgrace does not spur your compassion, then at least do this for the one that you raised out of the quagmire and into happiness. And may your intercession cut away the dangerous and sad consequences that might befall me because of the rage of an aggravated master and the imprudent reflection of this poor creature who, guided by my fame, which is resounding in Matanzas, thought he might find some support in me. Let's skip down here after the ellipsis. He is my brother, and his mistake has led to a state of hopefulness that is not well-founded. It is remarkable that even while Juan Francisco Manzano was still fulfilling his part of the bargain so that Del Monte would purchase his freedom, he began to negotiate on his brother's behalf. Manzano scribbled these words at the end of one of his letters, but these words were more than an afterthought. They were a bold petition motivated by radical love. Though Manzano did not mention Florencio by name, his message to Del Monte adopted the same tone he used in the slave narrative to communicate his fraternal bond. So we should pay attention to language like my brother's disgrace, this poor creature, he is my brother and his mistake has led to a state of hopefulness. Nearly 200 years later, Manzano's profound sense of empathy is palpable. Manzano did not straightforwardly request that Del Monte purchase his brother's freedom. Perhaps he wanted Del Monte to speak on his behalf with his former mistress to spare his brother physical abuse. We do not know for sure. What is more, we do not know if Del Monte ever replied. His letters either perished or were destroyed by parties close to him. One of the things that is interesting about this correspondence between Del Monte and Manzano is that Manzano's letters remain, but Del Monte's letters do not. Del Monte was prolific. He was the leading intellectual in Cuba at the time, and so we suspect that it has something to do with political problems that he and Manzano both had later when he was looking to disassociate himself from formerly enslaved people. But what's significant here is the way in which Manzano uses language in hope of winning Del Monte over. He talks about his brother's fate becoming more dire. And it leaves a space for us to interpret that either as his brother is suffering undue abuse, or that his brother believed that Manzano would have enough power to free him as well. But there's some sense that things are getting worse for his brother, and that his brother is unaware of Manzano's lack of power as an enslaved person, even someone who was on the cusp of being freed. He was to be freed the next year. I want to move now to the poem, A Dream to My Second Brother. And you also have some excerpts from that poem. Dreams are very important to understand the talk today. Manzano dreamt about his brother, and he translated those dreams into poetry. What's remarkable is that Manzano is vulnerable and tender in this poem, A Dream to My Second Brother. Manzano offered his readers something unusual, a vision of radical love expressed in the symbolic language of Congolese cosmology. I would demonstrate that Manzano's dream is a dream of Black liberation made possible by radical love. So dreams were an integral part to African religious culture, but they're also very important in Catholicism as well. And I want us to think about this from a number of different standpoints. First, let's talk about Catholicism. So if I were to ask you to raise your hand, and I will not, how many of you have had vivid dreams, good or bad? Dreams you will mention in public or dreams you will only whisper to your friends? How many of you have had night terrors? When you wake up, you're happy to find out it was not true. We all have dreams. The Catholic Church had a way of understanding dreams, and they thought of dreams as being either good or evil. They were concerned that people took dreams and thought of the dreams as message dreams, dreams that were communicating messages from God. Because the church was thinking in terms of the binary good and evil, they were looking to make sure that dreams were not evidence of pact with the devil, of a pact with the devil. The Romantics also were inspired by dreams. But for the Romantics, dreams were a space where logic didn't matter, where space was expanding, where characters changed, and perhaps most of all, where there was an ascent and a descent, an ascent into heaven, the possibility of dream fulfillment, and a descent, a terrible descent into chaos, as we'll see in the poem that I'm going to analyze today. The setting for Manzano's poem, A Dream to My Second Brother, is a forested mountain wilderness of Matanzas, known in Cuban Spanish as El Monte. The Cuban province of Matanzas held a particular significance for Juan Francisco Manzano because it was where his parents had died and where he had once been enslaved. But it was also where his brother remained in captivity, presumably under his former mistress, the Marchioness of Prado Ameno. Okay, let me take a moment here to show you the poem in question. What you'll see here on the right is an image of the poem from the Institute of Literature and Linguistics in Havana, Literatura Lingüística in Havana. And so you see the name here, Un Sueño. I was very excited to find this. This was among other materials that were in the process of perishing. So anytime we're able to find anything by a Black writer in Latin America that can be read, we're excited. You'll see Manzano's name at the end of the page. So the setting for Manzano's poem is indeed the mountain wilderness. Let me take a moment here to discuss the mountain wilderness. But let's start with verses of the poem itself. Florencio, you do know the sorrows that I grieve, how justified and understandable they torture my heart. Yes, you, who in bygone days would calm my suffering, or together with mine your tears also ran. I want to pay attention here to the fact that he uses apostrophe to address his brother by name. His brother is mentioned twice in the slave narrative. And so his brother is a sibling, this particular brother, his second brother, Florencio, is a sibling that gets the most attention. He talks about calming of suffering and the sharing of tears together, understanding each other's pain. Manzano then, in this particular poem, transitions from a moment where he's addressing his brother directly, so he begins to tell his brother about a dream that he had. And I'm going to read these stanzas as well and then provide a brief reading. Confused and aggrieved, burdened by a thousand woes, I search for solitude, fleeing from man, toward the nearby wilderness, where Quintana's hill adorns and dominates the inner spaces. I came to a forest, a refuge I frequent, to quarrel with myself and secretly lament. Whether from fatigue or lack of sleep, I close my eyes for a sweet and pleasant dream. There's three things I want us to pay attention to here. First is the fact that he talks about fleeing from man. Once again, Manzano is using euphemism as a way of communicating a greater idea here. The fleeing from man is a fleeing of slavery. So he imagines himself once again enslaved. This poem is published 2 years after his emancipation in 1838. He's emancipated in 1836. The second thing is that he flees to the nearby wilderness. In Cuba, the word monte can mean the wilderness, it can mean the mountains itself or the hills. It can also refer to the place of greatest sacred significance in the Congo religious tradition. The last thing I want us to think about here is how he ends these particular stanza, saying he closed his eyes for a sweet and pleasant dream. This is the dream that Manzano wants to fulfill. He wrote the poem in the present tense because even after legal manumission, the distressing wounds of the past continue to produce anguish, to torture the poet's spirit. Though Manzano's memory of slavery represents an aesthetic choice, he certainly could have written about other subject matter. We must conclude that the psychic wound of racial slavery was too recent to be discarded. Let's talk briefly about Emonte as an African tabernacle, searching for the kingdom of the dead. This is the second part of my analysis of the poem, A Dream to My Second Brother. So I'll begin with a modern map of Africa. Our interest here is not West Africa or the Upper Guinea Coast, but rather this region here, which is the Congo Basin. And we're going to go essentially to this particular part, northern Angola. Because our point of interest here is the ancient kingdom of the Congo. So I'm going to provide you something that I think is very cool. I like old maps, though I get lost all the time. And this is a 1750 map of the Kingdom of the Congo and other West African kingdoms. It's significant for us because the first Africans transported to Cuba in the early 16th century or 1500s were from the Kingdom of the Congo, and the Bakongo ethnic group in particular, which are King Congo speakers, were the persons that were brought to Cuba. Prior to 1820, the greatest number of captives sent to Cuba came from West Central Africa. So before 1820, Manzano was born when? 1797. So we don't know which ethnic group Manzano hailed from. That's less important than the type of cosmology that was present in his environment and the ways in which he would have been socialized into multiple cosmological understandings. Let's take this a step further. Let's look at the capital city of the Kingdom of the Congo, Mbanza, Congo. Anytime I get a chance to do this in class, I do. Ask my students. Now, I want to show you this in particular because, not only because it's a beautiful image produced by Ofert Dapper, but I also want you to look at it because it's meaningful for understanding why the forested wilderness or the mountain is Manzano's topic of conversation, or why he actually went to the mountain, essentially. What was understood in Congo thought is that the mountain represented in many ways their spiritual world. The upper part of the mountain was the land of the living, where we currently reside. The lower part of the mountain was the kingdom of the dead, and what divided it was a river. The river could be traversed, and it could be traversed because persons were understood to be able to pass from the world of the living to the dead, to pass from the world of the living to the dead regularly. There's a symbol that is used to communicate this. I'm going to show you in 1 second. Called the cosmogram. But this in particular may help you to picture the kingdom of the dead from a Cuban perspective. This is a picture of Matanzas, Cuba. And you'll see the bird there which is the image of Manzano, we can imagine, flying. If you really want to understand how beautiful this forested wilderness is, let me show you this second picture. You see the bridge going across it? I actually saw that bridge. I took these pictures. So that bridge gives you an idea of how deep the ravine is. You do not want to fall from there. You do not want to fall. Let's talk here briefly about the Congo cosmogram, which is present. It will help us to understand the poem. Now, the cosmogram is significant because it represents essentially two mountains. If you look at the upper half of the cosmogram, you can think of that as a mountain, as a triangle. The lower half would be the second part of that triangle, but it's an inverted triangle. So this would be the land of the living where we are all currently residing, thank God. And then we have the land of the dead or the kingdom of the dead, okay? This line in the middle is the river, okay? So the word Mpemba is the word that refers to the land of the dead where Manzano's parents were, okay? The creator known as Nsambi Mpungu is sighted at the top of the cosmogram, and the dead naturally are below. The dead naturally are below. I want to talk about dreams a bit more, however, because the dream sequence functions as a poet's guiding principle in this poem. To understand the poem deeper, transcultural meanings, we have to think about Congolese ideas of dreams. As sociologist Waleen Dotson says, the Bakongo ethnicity laid the epistemological foundations for Congolese spiritual practices on the island. One particular aspect of the Congolese idea for dreams that the dream is a voiceless communication. It's a means and a message at the same time. It's pictorial, it's audible, and it's scenic. The dream can be a reflection of daily activities, a repetition of past activities, or projection of one's own activities and imagination in the future. But quote, most importantly, it can be a warning about a future or imminent event, good or bad news. A dream interpreter is a person whose sensitivity to the awareness of waves, symbols, and their meanings are very high, end quote. And that's Bunseki Fukiao, a Congolese scholar. Manzano gave meaning to the array of symbols and images he encountered in his dreams. He translated those images into poetry so that they might be legible for Florencio and for his broader readership. Manzano was a dream interpreter whose sensitivity and awareness enabled him to derive meaning from symbols that emanated from the spirit world. Like Nat Turner before him, Juan Francisco Manzano's poem, A Dream to My Second Brother, invites us to reflect on the importance of dreams and visions in the history of social freedom. I want to proceed here with Manzano's flight into the center and landing in the center of the earth. So I'm going to bring up this passage so that we can discuss it. Quote, having seen so much from the air, I eagerly looked for the center of the earth to land my flight. I gather my feathers, I slightly tilt my chest, and turning in circles, I come down again in a well-aimed descent into the heart of Matanzas, from where I gaze on that terrible place. There lie the remains, the miserable remains of our parents who gave us our first being. These are perhaps the most important stanzas of the poem, and I want us to pay attention, obviously, to the parts that are marked in red. Manzano's coming to land in the center of the earth because in Congolese cosmology, that philosophy that is symbol, that is socialized, that one is socialized into, he understands the center of the earth as that point of equilibrium. And he's looking to establish contact with his dead parents and presumably call upon them to help him to liberate his brother. He turns his chest, he moves around in circles. Think of the cosmogram and think of that motion around the cosmogram, that motion that indicates essentially that life is a cycle, that persons are living, then dead, then living once again. Manzano talks about a well-aimed descent. In Romanticism, the notion of the descent is usually one falling into chaos. But here Manzano talks about something that lines up with a different idea. Landing in Matanzas to find his parents' remains and to acknowledge them as those that gave him his first existence, he and his brother. So in this case, he goes from speaking essentially in the first person singular, I gaze, to our first being. And so the first person plural is very important. I want to move towards the end here, thinking about Manzano's fall from grace, so to speak, falling like Icarus from the sky. And I'm going to use an image here as a way of making this easier to comprehend. So we have the flight of Icarus here by Jacob Peter Gowie. And Daedalus is Icarus's father. Icarus's mistake, we might say sin, was to fly too close to the sun. His wings of wax melt. And when they become nothingness, he is not able to sustain his flight. Okay? There are three modes of descent in the poem. Descent into the kingdom of the dead, descent onto the plantation to save the fraternal figure, Florencio, and descent into chaos, which is the poem's Icarus moment. Manzano said, quote, I eagerly looked for the center of the earth, end quote, in reference to the Congolese principle of the center of the earth as a sign of equilibrium between the spiritual and the natural realms. And again, invoking the Congolese idea that human remains of ancestors are sacred, Manzano wrote, quote, in well-aimed descent into the heart of Matanzas, from where I gaze, there lie the miserable remains of our parents who gave us our first being, end quote. The word miserable suggests that the bones cry out. They bear witness to the violence of slavery, to the violence that burial was intended to silence forever. Manzano's verses bespeak the Congolese idea about the persistence of life after death. Paris Thompson wrote, quote, that continuity might be characterized as a reinstatement of the Congo notion of the tomb as a charm for the persistence of the spirit, end quote. So now we need to think about those miserable remains as a way for the spirit to persist, to continue to exist in the natural world. So what happens? What happens here? Manzano's vision can be best understood by looking at the final verses that you all have in your hand. I'm going to produce all of it here for us. Okay, you do have that. Okay, great. So let me read here. Quote, Manzano's flying in the air. So think of the image of the bird flying over those beautiful hills in Matanzas. Quote, but since I couldn't quell in my heart the tender impressions of sweet brotherly love, anxious I descend to find the dear object of my affection as a strong Ethiopian overcoming his toils. I see him, recognize me. I kiss him, he enfolds me. And oh God, in this embrace I felt my affection grow. Let us flee, I told him, from this horrible place, more terrible in my view than hell itself. Let us flee, dear brother. Let us leave on the wind. Let us abandon forever our enemy soil. Now, these are very powerful set of stanzas. And I want to talk about these before we actually arrive at that Icarus moment. The first thing that I want to point out is the language of tender impressions and sweet brotherly love. So the empathy, this radical love that Manzano not only feels, is something that he also performs. Radical love is essentially a verb, it's an action. He says he could not quell in his heart, he could not quiet his feeling. He still feels responsible for his brother after so many years. So he descends, yet once again, now not to the grave where his parents are buried, but rather to where his brother is located. And he calls him a strong Ethiopian, and that might sound odd to us today because we know Ethiopia to be a country in East Africa, the long Christian tradition. What is Manzano talking about? Well, essentially, Ethiopian here is a way of talking about black people more generally. Ethiopian meaning burnt skin, right? This is the Greeks' way of talking about people they hadn't seen before, essentially. But it became, in the 19th century, a generic term for black. And so now he's using the term black to talk about his brother overcoming his toils. His brother as strong. Strong but tender at the same time. And then Manzano goes on to say, we must flee this place. It is worse than hell itself. And he calls Cuba, and this is striking, our enemy soil. He calls Cuba our enemy soil. I want to propose that the plantation for him, or the slave labor camp in Matanzas, is two things. That is locus horrendus, a terrible place, but his parents are buried there. So it's sacred to him as well. It's sacred to him as well. So he's struggling essentially with that notion of, do I stay or do I leave forever? And in the poem, he proposes flight. I have here the final verses that we'll talk about today. I'm going to give them all to you. Excuse me. I'm going to give them all to you here and read this as a way of wrapping up today. Quote, I traverse the mountains and I judge myself great lord of the winds, leaving behind the nations of America to save not my life, but rather the one that is nearly lost, like Icarus, the precipitous descent. I am surprised and I awaken, searching in my arms for the one that my dream took away, end quote. I want to place attention here on the fact that Manzano talks about flying away. He's very specific here because he says not only is Cuba his enemy soil, the enemy soil of his brother and he, but he then talks about the nations of America. In Spanish, it's los pueblos de America. And this is a conversation we just had in my Latin American Caribbean studies class, that America, how should we use this term, right? In this instance, he's definitely not talking about the United States. He never left Cuba. His work is published in England, but not because he traveled to England, right? It's smuggled out of Cuba. So this idea of America, this concept of America, not in this case as a place of freedom, but rather a place where his brother is overcoming toils that have been imposed upon him, a place of captivity. Once again, if we are to understand democratic praxis, we return to the institution of slavery with an interest of understanding, with the intent of understanding the philosophical contributions of the enslaved. Manzano then talks about becoming Icarus or being similar to Icarus. He uses a simile here. He has a precipitous descent. He awakens and his brother is no more in his arms. His brother is no longer in his arms. Manzano's vision was a dream deferred. His well-aimed descent devolved into chaos when the political winds suddenly changed and like Icarus, he fell from the sky. Manzano described the abrupt change thus, from so clear and beautiful, so gentle and serene, the night became dark, end quote. Manzano characterized his change of fortunes as horrendous warfare in the firmament. Darkness is the active metaphor to describe an emancipatory vision that had devolved into a nightmare. Like Icarus, who flew too close to the sun, Manzano's figurative wings melted into nothingness. And in a final act of brotherly love, Manzano exclaimed, quote, to save not my life, but rather the one that is nearly lost, end quote. Manzano's descent into chaos is a deep expression of loss, not the loss of his life or his social status, but rather the irretrievable loss of his younger brother, Florencio. The runaway slave turned famous writer was able to rescue his brother figuratively speaking, but he could not in reality save him. Was this poem's Manzano's way of explaining that he was unable to launch a successful campaign in the interest of emancipating his brother, a campaign similar to the one that saved him? In all likelihood, that was true. But because the poem had to pass the censors or censorship, Manzano's tongue was tied. I do not mean to say that Manzano was remarkable because he taught himself to read and write, but rather that there is a philosophy that undergirds his aesthetic practice, the philosophy of radical love. Empathy commingled with direct action in the interest of the spiritual needs of community and with the objective of fighting for the liberation of others. Thank you. If there are any questions,
I remember reading this in see you tomorrow.
Of his mother's name, or you mean the entire slate narrative? I'll repeat the question. A lot of people, I'll wait for people to, some people are transitioning from the living to the living, so we'll just wait. So the question essentially was, Manzano's slave narrative has existed in several iterations, and one of those iterations is a modernized Spanish version, as well as the English translation. There's two English translations, the original from 1840, and there's another translation that was produced in published at Wayne State University. So you're asking, what do I think essentially about the modernized Spanish version? Well, when I taught the graduate course, I wish I had used the modernized Spanish version. In my ambition, I used the original, the autographed manuscript, which any Spanish speaker will notice doesn't look like standard Spanish with a lot of idiosyncrasies. It is difficult for students, even for graduate students who have never been exposed to this type of writing, to understand the uniqueness of his penmanship. And I don't mean that literally, because you're reading something that's been typed. But there's a value at the same time to the autographed manuscript, which actually doesn't have his autograph, literally speaking. The value to it is that it gets you a little bit closer to the process of production. It brings you a little bit closer, it helps you to imagine Manzano hiding these sheets of paper, which I've seen. They would not let me take a picture. The Cubans refused to let me take a picture. And I don't blame them. But essentially, it gets you a little bit closer to that manuscript that he was writing. And it helps you to see not only the pain, the psychological duress he's under, but it gives you an idea. I believe that I can read better for the presence of the African cosmology in that document than I can in the more standardized version. So that's my answer. Does that answer your question? Okay. Any other questions? I'm sorry. We do not know. We do not know. We do not know if Manzano's brother ultimately achieved his emancipation. We do not know if his brother was able to, if he remained enslaved, or if perhaps he remained enslaved, but his situation became less severe, as was Manzano's case when he moved to Havana. He was no longer subjected to the same floggings. We don't know, because his brother's name drops out of the historical record after this poem in 1838. I said to the best of my knowledge, having consulted several archives in the US and in Cuba. So we have, in terms of references to his brother, direct references by name, we have two references in the slave narrative. And then we also have a reference to his brother in this poem. And then after that, his brother disappears. Manzano's trajectory changes in large part because of the other African-descended person who was considered a mixed-race person or a mulatto person. The other African-descended man standing next to him, Gabriel de la Concepción Valdez, he meets this other person, introduces himself, and they begin a literary conspiracy. So his trajectory changes, and that's what my book actually deals with. So we don't know. That's a long way of trying to answer your question. Lola, and then right here, okay.
Well, I only read autobiography of Fimaro in grad school, but I suppose he continued afterwards,
yes.
After 1840, the year it was published.
That's right, he did.
So how did his discursive style progress, and did he become more explicit in his protest and his fight for emancipation in his following years?
I believe that he did. The first part of the answer to your question would be that after the publication of his slave narrative in London in English, which doesn't mention, his name is not mentioned, his last name is not mentioned, his first name is mentioned. So it's kind of silly in a way. It says Juan F. And you're like, well, who could that be? Briefly, it was published in London by an Irishman who was a devoted and very serious abolitionist. He was a very serious abolitionist. And he did work for the British in interest of ending the illegal slave trade to Cuba.
That was his work. He had been in Jamaica, and the Spanish hated him, as did the Cubans, because their economy depended on slave labor. Manzano did continue to produce after that manuscript in a standardized Spanish form, actually. William Luis actually demonstrates this. And a standardized Spanish form is smuggled out of Cuba to London and then translated into an English that, to me, looks almost nothing like the original. He continued to produce. He produced probably the most significant thing would be a play called Safira, which is essentially a play based in North Africa. And he has a black African character in that play that is an enslaved person that is essentially a rebel. And I don't work on that play in detail, but there are others that do so. That is a very important piece of work. And in that play, he essentially adopts a stronger abolitionist critique. But I should add something else. Another difficult thing when studying Manzano is that the anti-slavery poems were, for the most part, not published in his lifetime, even though they could have been published in London. So for some reason, some poems Madden chose not to publish. One was called The Absent Slave Woman, and that poem essentially implicated white male slave owners in sexual violence against black women. And I think that Madden perhaps chose not to publish it because he thought it would hurt his political cause. It wouldn't make things easier for him to fight for the end of slavery in Cuba. Any other questions? Oh, we had one over here. This is my translation.
It is yours.
In large part. I do my own translations for literature, whether it's poetry, letters, autobiography. But this particular poem, it has an interesting story. There's a professor by the name of Pablo Garcia at West Virginia State University, I believe it's called. And he actually helped with this translation. So his hand is here, my hand and his hand is here. Yeah, but when you look at the postscript that I read as if it were a letter, that's my translation, as is with the slave narrative. Thank you. Any other questions? Any of the students? I want one student question. Okay. Your question, then I would love to have one student question. Okay. If there's a student question. I hope it was legible. Yes. Well, translation is itself an intellectual, and to an extent, a creative process, but it's a very important intellectual process. I aim for dynamic equivalency. So what I aim to do is to translate the text in a way that will not distort the meaning, the original meaning of the author, that will reflect the nuances, but that will be amenable and legible to a modern public. And so I don't use words like whilst from 19th century English that Richard Robert Madden used, which was appropriate at that time. But and if I feel that my translation, if there's a lot of reason, if there's the need for an explanation, I put it in footnotes. Mm-hmm. Another question? Okay, right here. Okay. When he addressed his brother by name.
This is where he refers to the miserable remains.
Okay.
So now the second set of verses at the bottom of the page, this is a continuation of what's about, is it an exact continuation of what is it called? In other words, on the English side, who first gave us our first life, mm-hmm. Is that continued with "there I sat down for a while"? The continuation.
I'm trying to find where "there I sat down." Are you talking about these four stanzas on page? I want to make sure I have your copy. I'm actually looking at. I don't have your copy. Oh, I follow. No, those, they don't follow. I don't believe it follows exactly like that. Yeah, there's a leap there. The poem is actually available in English, but it's available by Richard Robert Madden. As much as I respect his political work, I don't think that the translation gives you the same feel. Yeah. There are 47 stanzas in the poem. He wrote very long poems. I mean, I think he wanted to be a novelist. He said that was his plan, essentially, to sit down to write a novel. And then he met Plácido, and they conspired together. So he did not end up writing that novel. He did not. Any other questions? Oh, okay, so I'll answer this in two, and I'll try to answer it briefly. I first actually came across his slave narrative as a graduate student at Michigan State University, something that Lola and I actually shared. We studied under one of the same professors of literature there that we really respect. That's when I first encountered it, and I was surprised to see a slave narrative in Spanish. I had never come across it. But initially, I did not want to write about it. So I wrote my final paper about something else. It had nothing to do with it. Because there's a lot of pain tied up in the whole question of exploring slavery. I came back to it as a graduate student because I was sure that I wanted to do something about black people in Latin America. And I was more interested in the 19th century, where you have a lot of the emergence of a lot of black writers in different parts of Latin America, than I was in the 20th century. And so I had to go back and look at slavery again. Manzano in particular, and this poem in particular, I'll add, is important to me in the Spanish version of the poem. I'm sorry, in the original article that I published in Cuba in Del Caribe, I dedicated it to my younger brother who passed. So this poem speaks to me in so many ways. And actually something made the presentation together difficult at certain moments. So Manzano speaks to me because his performance of black masculinity is one where there's resistance, resilience, but at the same time, there's not a loss of empathy and love. And I think that's something to be modeled in literature and imitated if possible. The poem actually ends with him falling from the sky and awaking from his dream. It's so incredibly long, I didn't give you the final stanza. I think I'm gonna have to provide this poem for people. People in the Spanish department have a copy of it, but when I get done translating it out, because I'm translating it for the manuscript anyway.
What I was curious about mm-hmm. was that this imagery of flying, at least in the American, the U.S. context, is often of the flying Africans returning back home.
That's right. It does. It does have this type of connection. There's so many nuances in the text that I tried to choose what I mentioned and what I didn't mention. What I wanted to emphasize essentially was that he was leaving the Western Hemisphere. There was a way of him reading the Western Hemisphere as irretrievably lost because it was a land of slavery. It was a land where freedom was impossible for persons of African descent or black persons, as we would say in the United States. But the notion that he will return to Africa, and that's implied, it is not said, but it is implied that he would return to Africa, was common among the belief of blacks in Latin America, particularly African persons have been born in Africa, that once they died, their spirits would return to the continent. And so I find it very important that he talks about a first being, because it implies that there'll be a second one, essentially. Any other questions? Yes.
I'm just really curious about, I guess, maybe the least interesting aspect of, or tangential to the questions you're asking here, but I'm kind of struck by the formal elements of the poem that, you know, I mean, it's not exactly complex, it's close, but like these are pretty slant lines a lot of the time. Mm-hmm. I'm wondering if you could sort of situate this, if we can look at some of those choices he's making, and do those suggest anything about the formal universe of what poetry is existing along with and dialogue mm-hmm. with? Does it suggest anything about because some of the idiosyncrasies of orthography and formal choices here, there might be kind of, this is a very sort of linguist question, I know, about
it is.
Occult studies proposed
Well, I'll say this very briefly. I'll give you the best answer I can to that. Most of my attention to the poem in terms of form has been to the romantic and neoclassical elements. For the sake of time, I didn't get into the fact that in the Spanish-speaking Caribbean, romanticism and neoclassicism coexist. So romanticism was a reaction essentially to the emphasis on the classical, to this notion that you had to write poetry in a certain way. But in the Spanish-speaking Caribbean, not only in Cuba, but in the Dominican Republic and Puerto Rico as well, the 19th century represents a moment in which whites and some persons of African descent are for the first time producing what they can deem literature, what they can present to a metropolitan audience as such. And these are persons that, depending upon where they are situated in the world, are being educated abroad. So with regard to this poem, what most strikes me, I haven't paid much attention to rhyme in this poem or meter, but what most strikes me is the fact that he uses the dream state, the romantic dream state, as a way to, in a very, to make palatable to a larger audience, these spiritual ideas that are unorthodox. But not only unorthodox because economically disenfranchised white Cubans in the countryside would have believed in dreams because they did, but because he's now taking feathers in his hand, landing in the center of the earth, turning into a bird, and talking about his parents' bones, right? So I've been more interested in looking at the poem as an example of transculturated colonial literature, as an example of a literary text that is situated on the periphery, but it's palatable to a metropolitan audience. And then at the end of the poem, how can a romantic poem, if romanticism is a reaction to neoclassicism, romanticism is about writing what you feel, it's an expression of freedom in verse, essentially, how could Icarus appear? Icarus is not supposed to be there. So those types of choices, I think, have been what I've paid the most attention to. But there is some other work on the poem that I could suggest if you were interested. Any other questions? Thank you very much for coming out and for staying.